Chapter 20. They brought out the knot and hung it from the flagpole. They brought out the official square wooden table for the challenger to stand on. And from the moment Maniac climbed up, you could tell the knot was in big trouble. To the ordinary person, Cobble's knot was about as friendly as a nest of yellow jackets. Besides the tangle itself, there was the weathering of that first year when the knot hung outside and became hard as a rock. You could barely make out the individual strands. It was grimy, moldy, crusted over. Here and there, a loop stuck out, maybe big enough to stick your pinky finger through. Pitiful testimony of the challenger who had tried and failed. And there stood Maniac, turning the knot, checking it out. Some say there was a faint grin on his face, kind of playful, as though the knot wasn't his enemy at all, but an old pal just playing a trick on him. Others say his mouth was more grim than grin, that his eyes lit up like flashbulbs because he knew he was finally facing a knot that would stand up and fight a worthy opponent. He lifted it in his hands to feel the weight. He touched it here, touched it there, gently, daintily. He scraped a patch of crust off with his fingernail. He laid his fingertips on it as though feeling for a pulse. Only a few people were watching at first, and half of them were Hex Angels, a roving tricycle gang of 4 and 5 year olds. Most of them had had a sneaker lace or yo-yo knots untied by Maniac, and they would expect that this would only take a couple seconds longer. When the seconds became minutes, they started to get antsy, and before 10 minutes had passed, they were zooming off in search of somebody to terrorize. The rest of the spectators watched Maniac poke and tug and pick at the knot. Never a pull or yank, but his fingertips touching and grazing and pecking away like some little bird. "What's he doing?" somebody said. "What's taking so long? He gonna do it or not?" After an hour, except for a few more finger-sized loops, all Maniac had to show for his trouble were the flakes of knot crust that covered the table. "He ain't even found the end of the string yet," somebody grumbled, and almost everybody but Amanda took off. Maniac never noticed. He just went on working. By lunchtime, they were all back, and more kept coming. Not only kids, but grown-ups, too. Black and white, because Cobble's Corner was on Hector, and word was racing through the neighborhoods on both the east and west sides of the street. What people saw, they didn't believe. The knot had grown, swelled, exploded. It was a frizzy globe. The newspaper the next day described it as a gigantic hairball. Now, except for a packed-in clump at the corner, it was practically all loops. You could look through it and see Maniac calmly working on the other side. "He found the end," somebody gasped, and the corner burst into applause. Meanwhile, inside, Cobbles was selling pizza left and right, not to mention Zepps, a 2 mils type of hoagie, steak sandwiches, strombolis, and gallons of soda. Mr. Cobble himself came out to offer Maniac some pizza, which Maniac, of course, politely turned down. He did accept an orange soda, though, and then the little kid, whose sneaker laces Maniac had untied many a time, handed up to him a 3-pack of Tasty Cake Butterscotch Crimpets. After polishing off the crimpets, Maniac did the last thing anybody expected. He lay down and took a nap right there on the table, the knot hanging above him like a small, hairy planet, the mob buzzing all around him. Maniac knew what the rest of them didn't. The hardest part was yet to come. He had to find the right roots to untangle the mess, or it would just close up again like a rock and probably stay that way forever. He would need the touch of a surgeon, the alertness of an owl, the cunning of 3 foxes, and the foresight of a grandmaster in chess. To accomplish that, he needed to clear his head, to flush away all distraction, especially the memory of the butterscotch crimpets, which had already hooked him. In exactly 15 minutes, he woke up and started back in. Like some fairy tale tailor, he threaded the end through the maze, dipping and doodling through the openings the way he squiggled a football through a defense. As the long August afternoon boiled over, the exploded knot hairball would cave in here, cave in there. It got lumpy, out of shape, saggy. The Times photographer made starbursts with his camera. The people munched on Cobble's pizza and spilled across Hector from sidewalk to sidewalk and said, "Oh, ah." And then, around dinner time, a huge roar went up, a volcano of cheers. Cobble's knot was dead, undone, gone, It was nothing but string.